there that we should have a good relationship with this institute. I came back and made a proposal, and my colleague, Dr. Kumari, then worked on that, proposed it further, it was clear, and that is the background to this particular event and particular event. But what about the centrality of political economy to ISAS? ISAS, as a think tank, has three major areas where we are active. There is foreign and security policy of South Asia, then there is trade and industry and economy, and then state, society and governments. These are the three main areas which is a mandate given to us by the ministries, and we have given ourselves an extra mandate to talk about, that is to look at not just the land mass of South Asia, the eight countries from Afghanistan all the way to Maldives, but also to the water space. So the governance of the Indian Ocean has become a part of our function, and we are supporting it under governance, but it is emerging as an area by itself. Similarly, we are connected to South Asia, but South Asia is where South Asians are. There are 20 to 30 million South Asians spread all over the world outside South Asia, that the South Asian diaspora, very powerful, very large community, and we connect to it every second year. By the way, of the South Asia Diaspora Convention. These are the five areas of function of ISAS, and it functions not just by the activities of its own researchers and administrators. We are certified in all, about 50 researchers and residents, and the others are spread out in South Asia, they visit us from time to time. But we also function by connecting to partner institutions, and that is where ADRI comes in. The partnership is based, again, on complementarity. ISAS in a think tank is engaged in communicating the findings of research to our stakeholders, but not being a university type institution, we are not deeply engaged in fieldwork or long-term research projects, which is actually the strong point of ADRI. And Dr. Shaibal Gupta will be speaking to us, after me, to tell you a lot more about their institute. So I thought we should be adding strength to strength, going to deep research findings from ADRI, but use Singapore and ISAS as a hub to project them worldwide. And that way, we thought both sides will be gained, and we have got similar MOUs with a number of other institutions. So now that I've given you the background, let me say a little something about the substance of the kind of research that I hope we will be engaged in. As you know, there's this famous book which says India grows at night. I would like to add that India is growing in the south, because south of the Indus are the parts of India that are taking off. Whatever happened to the east, as you might know, Singapore is strongly connected to Nalanda University, and the whole idea is that the east, Nalanda, Bihar, they were main sort of sites of art, architecture, knowledge in pre-modern times. Even after independence, Bihar, for one thing, got a prize from the great evaluator of governance, Mr. Appleby. Professor gave Bihar a number one rank. How did that state go from being a model of governance to what is called the general draft? So whatever happened to the East, that remains a major area of research. And I thought I would get engaged in research on the East. So I picked up Tripura, Bihar, and West Bengal as three comparative cases and launched a research project. And the book is about to come. I will just draw on a little bit on the findings to show you where there is room to maneuver. Most of the time, the East is lumped together, the kind of lumpiness, as if it is undifferentiated. But when you look more closely at the Eastern states, which are sometimes also dismissed as Bimar, which in Hindi means sick states, they are not all that sick. If you are looking at some of the statistical findings, you'll find that we have this picture of stagnation, there is dynamism. For example, if you start with the percentage of people under the poverty line, all over India in 1993-94, the data statistics outline of India will tell you 45% were below poverty line, and that has gone down to 22% in 2011-12, all over India. In Bihar, as you notice, it was much higher. 61% of the population was under the poverty line, but that has come down to 34% in 2011-12. Compared to Bihar, West Bengal, which was at 40%, has actually gone down to 20%. And Tripura, the tiny northeastern state, which is 33%, is now down to 14%. So there's this kind of decline in all of them, but some have gone down a lot further. Or for that matter, consumption expenditure, which we are also using as an indicator of income or how much one has to live on. Bihar had, in terms of rupees per month per person, 56 in 1774. It has gone up to 417 in 2004-2005. If you're looking at West Bengal, which was below Bihar in 1973-74 at 47 rupees per person per month, has gone up all the way to 562. So the time has gone up. I'll go quickly now. If you are looking at literacy rates, Bihar, which had 13% literacy in 1951, has gone up to 62. And West Bengal, which had 24, has gone up to 76. Once again, a picture of variation. Social service indicators. Bihar had a rank of 18 in 2001. It is still at 18 in 2011. Whereas West Bengal, which had the 9th place, has gone up to the 6th place. And interestingly, Bihar was split 6 between Bihar and Jharkhand. The two states, which were once one, are also performing differently. Jharkhand has gone past Bihar in terms of social service indicators. And in terms of, now I'll come to not just social services or the economy, and talk about political indicators. Bihar had the rate of murder 43 per million in 2001, and it has gone down to 30. But West Bengal, which was 19, has gone down even further. Picture for riots is even more interesting. Riots in Bihar have actually gone up a little, whereas riots in Bengal have come down. So all of it put together to show that this lumpiness of the Northeast is a differentiated picture, and within this lumpiness you find shining examples of success as well. So the task in front of us is to understand why does within the same region such variation occur, and who are the voters, who are the movers and shakers of the world, what role does politics play, and what role do political elites play? These are some of the issues around which we have a number of presentations. There will be a presentation by Neeraj Kumar on the BCIM corridor in the context of Eastern Indian political economy and state society relations and economic problems in Vice Chair of Odisha by my colleague, Dr. Sojit Shen, and political economy of Tista River Basin from Amit Landry. Dr. Amit is one of our water specialists. The other one is Faisal from Pakistan. What I said that is to identify areas that matter, and I go out of my way to recruit people. Then after the debate, we'll have Dr. Avinash Mahanti talking to us about climate change adaptation, social economic implications. Once again, that Singapore or ISAS are driven by economic growth does not mean we don't look at the dark consequences of growth in terms of what it does to the environment. And that is again a new area, relatively new area for ISAS, but once again, we always need to add a figure, we anticipate areas that will become important and we take to record it. The final paper today would be by my colleague, Dr. Amitan Dimane, research leading in trade and economic policy of ISAS. His paper will be on economic potential of Eastern India, the emerging sector. And there will be a chance for a proper panel discussion among the audience. So that's a question and answer session to come down. So these papers should be carefully listened to and picked up so that we will know where they hit, where they missed, and what we should do next time around. Because part of the agenda today is also to prepare the agenda for our future to bring this introductory words to an end, I'll allow myself to say a couple of things more. I've already indicated that we are a think tank, and think tank of South Asia. And we're not here because South Asia is there, but because Singapore is here. Our job is to connect one to the other, and the other to the one, and look at what is developing, and think about what are the possibilities open, and what are the best ways forward, what are the costs and benefits of action. That's the kind of policy research that we do. Now, policy and research sometimes point in different directions. The need of the moment is policy. Research has a very different dimension. It's not just about one particular time and space. Research claims the distinction of eternity. Or in other words, we will quote from my colleague, Dr. Subrata, former governor of the Reserve Bank of India, with President Gandhi. He reminded me this morning that the challenge is to go from knowledge to wisdom. So what kind of wisdom can politically, economy or development give us or encourage us to look at? I'll name only two. First, the main political economy theorists have thought about the phases of development, how to go, for example, in Rusto, from primitive accumulation to feudalism to capitalism to socialism and beyond that, and how to make it self-sustaining. Those researchers have not particularly worried about the losers of development. That came in later in terms of the social history of development, and today it has acquired a completely different face, particularly in countries like India, where legitimacy as important as growth and order. So we ask, what is the unit of measurement of development? Is it a country, a region, or is it individual? In more, we ask, should we tell people, like Prime Minister John Major once said, a great for a deity, if you have a problem, get on your bike and get moving, like you go where development is taking place. Look at it another way. I don't want to give up my living space, my culture, my context. I want to develop where I live, or development should come to my doorstep. That is what the justice argument is about. That's why when one talks about development in India, one automatically asks, development for whom, development of whom, and is there a regional balance in this development? These are new theoretical challenging questions. So what are the units of measurement and how do we measure them? Then the next and final challenge for me as a researcher in the field practice is to bring theory back in here. What is the difference? When you are doing policy analysis, you are given a structure and you are asked, here is the structure, here is the space, here is the furniture. Put it together such a way that it will maximize efficiency, visibility, and aesthetics, and you will have an orderly session. That's policy. When it comes to theory, all bets are off. You are allowed to ask ultimate questions about what is, who is the actor, what is the context, and what is the time horizon. So, I was in Beijing once and I was visiting some folks, relatives of one of my students, and this, I was admiring the lovely high-rise building, outside the building some nice exercise area, old people exercising. I said, how lovely. Then they looked at me sadly and they said, as recently as last year, this was the area of Beijing which used to produce flowers. It was the flower garden of Beijing. I said, well, what happened? Well, it was decided that this should become a high-rise building. Whatever happened to the flower garden? They have been moved away 200 kilometers, but there are rapid connections. They can make their flower there and bring their here. Now, the policy question should have been how to design that space. The theory question should have been whether. And researchers, particularly young researchers, like my own colleagues, must ask both questions. What is the policy implication and what does it mean to theory? How do we add theory to policy questions and give a policy relevance to theory? Those are then the various issues at stake. I'll have a chance to come back at the end of the session. I would leave you all by once again thanking so many interesting people, so many important people. I see our very dear friend, Mr. Chandaria, of the Chandaria Fame from Africa and Singapore. I see my colleague, from South Asia Study Program, also with the partnership, and so many of my distinguished colleagues, and I'll have a chance to thank people properly when I finish. So thank you all for listening. I'll give the floor now to Dr. Shaibal Gupta, and I wish you all a good conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mitra. It is now my pleasure to now invite Dr. Shaibal Gupta, Member Secretary, Asian Development Research Institute, India, to deliver the opening remarks for the Roundtable of the countries.
During the inaugural session, in full view of national and international press. He made a reliance of all electronic media immediately. And next day, all the newspapers of the country carried his photograph to the president, the front page. Possibly on that page itself, the deal of association of ISAS and ADRI is clinched. Today, we are to be formalizing that association. Whereas the mandate of your institute is South Asia, our mandate is international. But to be very frank, we have been working mainly on Neera, which is one of the peripheral regions of India. If India is south, then Bihar is south within south. I think I prefer marginally to you, sir. You referred about Apple report. Apple never mentioned that Bihar was one of the best governments, like they didn't mention. And you have yourself written that this story, where he had mentioned about Bihar, democratically endorsed his governments. Now we have transcended beyond. We are engaged with India in general and Eastern India in particular. I am sure the association with ISIS, we shall transcend beyond our country on our academic interest. The mandate of South Asia is itself a demanding research. In the Asian backdrop, this area has one of the most vibrant social fabrics. Here, a million mutinies are taking place all the time. The bulk of South Asia is essentially pre-British India. In some sense, South Asia has not yet emerged significantly in the competitive world of the West as an economic priority. Though we are fast entering into national and international industrial rate, domestically and foreign, we are becoming increasingly part of the international capital structure in a very vibrant way. In recent years, India has been able to create distinct identity in the information technology sector. The temptation to see Asia as one unit is a distinctly Eurocentric construct. The cultural construct of Asia is essentially meant East Asia. This was further reinforced by Lee Kuan Yew, the founder of your country, when he said that by East Asian, I mean Korea, Japan, China, Vietnam, as distinct from Southeast Asia, which is a mix between civic India, although Indian culture very similar values. It is extremely necessary to understand the heterogeneity of this Asian tradition. We shift our attention from East Asia to Indian subcontinent and a vibrant tradition of nurturing a dialogue with society. Unlike Confucius-centric East Asian values, which symbolizes two central themes, loyalty to family and obedience to state, India was not only the largest religious literature in the world, it had also the largest volume of aesthetics and materialistic writing. The fondness for arguing and dialogue was a distinctive character of Indian tradition, unlike ordered and discipline championed in the mainstream East Asian values. It was therefore not surprising that when it came to surging ahead in the economic sphere, it was East Asia which had attained great heights. At this juncture, we are yet to know whether South Asia will be able to split an alternative path. When one thinks of South Asia as a distinct region, one is often inclined to visualize both South and Southeast Asia together, not only for social and political reasons, but from an agro-climatic perspective also. Indeed, these two regions together form river called Monsoon Asia. Those familiar with this region cannot but notice enormous similarity in flora and fauna across the region, resulting similarly in social values and cultural practices. This is an obvious indication for their development strategy. Specifically, the key question that engages policymakers in South Asia in the sphere of development, whether techno-managerial strategy is adequate or they need to be accompanied by important institutional reforms. Most of these Asian countries completed their institutional reforms immediately after Second World War. In contrast, the countries of South Asia are still struggling with their legacy of history. General reform is still a far cry. Over and above, component of knowledge society is to get its implemented. In the meantime, the fourth industrial revolution ushers in with the foundation of artificial intelligence, which is not yet in the future. Global development will reach an unprecedented proportion, which will be beyond our imagination. Will South Asia continue to be supplier of software rather than being supplier of hardware? I would like to conclude this contention that our institute is some sort of bottom-up organization. And they have been functioning in one of the most painful places in the country. We have a center on public finance. We have a center on climate change. We have a center on health. We have a center of international growth center supported by Indian language school and Oxford University. So we are essentially trying to understand the changes which is taking place at a regional level. Our main idea is to bring about capitalist transformation in the eastern region. Because capitalism is still a very bad word in the context of India. So when we say about the capitalist transformation, we want to end feudalism as well. Because without the institutional reform, we cannot bring about that transformation. Now, unfortunately, other than West Bengal, where the institutional reform has taken place, most of the eastern part of the country is without institutional. So essentially when we are looking towards Singapore, our whole essential idea that how to get globally and internationally connected with the industrial and economic frames. Because in some sense, we need to replicate what Singapore has done in the last couple of years. Essentially it has been the main fulcrum for transformation of Asia and leading it to connection with the national and international industry. If we are able to do that itself, it would be very interesting. What we expect that not only is going to be some sort of bottom-up ideas from Eastern India, but also top-down ideas from the institute so that we can really bring about a dramatic transformation at our part of the country. Because still, the cognitive world of the leaders, all over Indonesia, is very limited. So we want the cognitive world should become as global as Singapore is in this field. So I don't want to speak much beyond this point, but I'm sure the association with your institute will bring about on operating in our institute, it will bring about a dramatic change in the eastern part of the country and also in South Asia. Thank you.
Now to the signing of the Memorandum of Understanding between the Institute of South Asian Studies, NUS, and the Asian Development Research Institute, India. The Institute of South Asian Studies, NUS, will be presented by Professor Subrata, Director and Visiting Research Professor, NUS. And the Asian Development Research Institute, India, will be presented by Dr. Shaibal Gupta, Member Secretary, ISAS-ADRI. Roundtable session titled Political Economy of Development in Eastern India. I would like to invite Dr. Shaibal Gupta to chair the session. Dr. Gupta, please.
In my opinion, the regional history played a big role in the evolution of each region of India during British period, four factors have mattered most: the arrival of East India Company, second, the system of land trading system, referring earlier, the pattern of public investment, and the nature of social movements. We can discuss all these things in more details by participating in the discussion. Eastern region had this one advantage on all four counts. Even in the post-independent period, the disadvantage of Eastern India was not that. In spite of huge increase in planned and non-planned investment, the Eastern region remained by all economic indicators lowest rung of the ladder. Over and above, the absence of land reform other than Bengal and freight equalization policy practically paralyzed the economic turnaround in post-independent period. The pattern of industrialization in British India is another important reason for Eastern India to suffer in post-independence period. In British India, industrialization of both West and South Asia was based on domestic capital, whereas East India, industrialization rested mainly on British capital. So the departure of British did not affect its industrialization of South and East, but in spite of British capital, after industrialization, Eastern India suffered as the local capital in India was mainly mercantile capital and thus unable to acquire space vacated by British capital. The Northern India did not have much industrial capital in the colonial period. Thanks to the location of Delhi, it had received considerable state support for its industrialization. With this initial remark, I would like to round the start and invite the first speaker of the conference. The first speaker is Mr. Neeraj Kumar, who will be speaking on political economy of development, and he will be speaking on crouching tigers, flying dragons, the BCIM corridor in limbo. Neeraj is a executive editor at ISAS-ADRI.
May first, I would also thank Professor Mitra and the whole ISAS team and ISAS-ADRI who have given me all the opportunities to submit. My first occasion in Singapore, I'm speaking along with some of my old friends as they were a part of ISAS, like and ISAS-ADRI. We all know that in coming to the topic, we all know we have been talking of corridors and we have been talking of special economic zones all the time. What is so special about this corridor? In fact, many of us are not even clear about what constitutes purely technical terms the economic corridor. Actually, India has very least experience in all these fields. The one corridor that India can drop off is about Delhi-Bombay corridor. It's not a completely industrial corridor, but part of that is the industrial corridor, some senses. Some 136 or 140 kilometers of that corridor, which is some 1300 kilometers long, is the economic corridor actually. And it's been connected by nodes and internodes and several transchangeable points and all. So that sort of forms some kind of economic corridor. But this corridor is not going to be exactly like that. This corridor is connecting four countries. And in fact, interesting, one of the most underdeveloped regions of China is the most underdeveloped region of India, that's India's northeast and south, China's southwest, that is Yunnan province. So I'm going to present my arguments and I will be looking forward to some interesting questions and discussions, because discussions are more important in international relations. To talk briefly, this BCIM corridor was initially conceptualized as Track 2 initiative, and it's interesting to note again that this route is not yet an economic corridor, it's purely technical terms. This route refers to this corridor refers to a route for trade, connectivity and people-to-people ties that would begin from Kunming in China to Kolkata in India via Myanmar to Bangladesh. Recently, some Chinese experts have said that except for 200 kilometers stretch in India, that is between Silchar in Assam and Manipur, and exactly of the same length, 200 kilometers stretch in Myanmar, that's the name of the places, Kaleva and Muniwa, these two places are connected by 200 kilometers, not so well road. So, except this corridor, the central artery of this route is completely functional. How much trade is happening, I don't know, and what kind of shape is likely to take in the coming months, we don't know yet, because we are not having that much data with this, because not only because of this is a multilateral thing, but also because even India's bilateral trade with China is not very in good shape, and India is always complaining about the trade deficit with China. But the project which Indian foreign policy establishment is widely accused of, in fact, holding by its diplomatic maneuvers and all, has not seen expected head since the first BCIM forum meet that was called in Kunming in 1999 when it all started. So right from creating connectivity infrastructure to establishing telecom networks, this ambitious project holds much in store for developing a whole belt around this route, and this belt has the potential to not just bring in further prospects of developing these two underdeveloped regions of China and India, but also to the other parts of Eastern India. That's why I chose to keep it Eastern India, not only Northeastern India. So Odisha and West Bengal are very much a part of this corridor. Who will be benefiting if this corridor ever becomes operational in technical or other terms? But when I talk of this corridor, obviously Odisha, West Bengal and Northeastern states are at advantage. But we never talk about our two other partners of this corridor, Bangladesh and Myanmar. Bangladesh is a very important neighbor for it, economically or trade-wise or any other sense. But we hardly care about our relationship with Bangladesh. And I don't think that India can imagine benefiting from this corridor without taking confidence into Bangladesh and Myanmar that, okay, you are also going to develop from this corridor, you are also going to benefit from this corridor as much as Chinese will do or Indians will do. So that's the question for all researchers. Now I am going to talk about two perspectives which are very important perspectives. One is Indian and another is Chinese, because we all know in India and China West perspectives do not matter, because it is these two pillars, India and China, that will be keeping this corridor alive. The perspective, Indian perspective, is that BCIM is essentially a part of China's memorandum strategy called Duo, just to create its hegemony in world economy, and it's ultimately a prelude to China's possible aspirations of achieving global political supremacy. This particular perspective does find favors with the current Indian establishment. In fact, when whether it is China's corridor with Pakistan, that's called CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or BCIM, both predate the origin of OBOR. So when BCIM started, no OBOR was there. When CPEC started, OBOR was just taking some sort of shape. So one cannot complain that BCIM, and one should not look at BCIM and CPEC from the lens of OBOR. Because of course, OBOR, when China has certain bigger ambitions, it might have. But academically, we haven't been able to establish so. While India's apprehensions behind its long sustained strategy, which was not the case in Manmohan Singh's era, of hibernating its northeastern part might be little misplaced, China's recent acts, widely reflected in cases such as Doklam standoff and frequently reported skirmishes along with Indian armed forces and all other military forces in Ladakh. So these are some pointers which do point to a particular notion and strengthen such perspectives which Indians are, in fact, Indian foreign policy establishment harboring. Further, we all know that they used to be, in fact, that road is still there, but not in a proper shape. This is still well known that
that was constructed during World War II, and that connected, there's a place called Lido in Assam to Kunming in Yunnan. But we all know that Kunming is well connected to Hong Kong and other areas in South Asia, very well. But we haven't been able to establish a proper link from Assam or any other northeastern states to Kunming. So once this steel railroad is still it's renovated or some kind of arrangement is done that expressway can be made there. So that will be directly taking all the Indian goods and all Bangladeshi or Myanmarese goods to Hong Kong port. As facilitating way, and you can say they don't have to just rely on one vehicle in one path, that is the sea route. So that will be opening a kind of overland passage. Secondly, interestingly and ironically, in fact, Planning Commission document that was prepared in 2014, that also did never mention northeastern region to be one of its important regions for promoting trade and ties with other countries, the countries which we are considering for BCIM corridor. So that shows the attitude of Indian government at that time. And I will talk about what the current government is doing on these particular aspects in that regiment. So the unofficial sub-regional conceptualization of this corridor does extend its scope from India's northeast to eastern provinces of Odisha and West Bengal. But all these issues somewhere converge to one point, that from where India is fighting, in fact, that's a point where from where India is finding it very difficult, very, very difficult to depart in terms of strategic planning or in terms of diplomatic maneuverings, whatever. Meanwhile, India's failure to undergo a shift from 1999 to 2017, so this is a long period of 18, 20 years, the Indian approach of tackling BCIM agendas has now pushed China to think that even if BCIM is not happening, it can at least go ahead with CPEC. So that is why there might be a certain kind of sluggishness on Chinese part, that they are not focusing on BCIM project as well. So we can't totally accuse Indian government or Indian establishment one that they are not focusing or they are not serious about BCIM corridor. In fact, Chinese are too also not serious about this corridor. So they keep on blaming each other, and the whole blame game ultimately comes down to talk about Myanmar and Bangladeshi side arguments. We can't move on that without that. In fact, India also thinks that CPEC, BCIM are just two flags out of many other flags. The almost grand strategy and are grossly in debt boosting prospects for Chinese encirclement of India through Indian Ocean and all other regions. So this encirclement is also kind of apprehension, which might be true, which might not be true. As an academician, I can't say anything without looking at the evidence for it, and the evidences and data we don't have. Just a few stray incidents of Chinese ships and moving along Bay of Bengal or going the other side. The Arabian Sea does not indicate that Chinese are trying for any sort of encirclement. This might be an apprehension for the policy hawk's mind, but I don't think so that is going to be the case in the future. Now I will come and I will talk just two small things about JSCs. JSCs actually were a kind of carrier to propel this particular agenda before the world, and especially for countries. The JSCs actually were joint study groups. So JSC was formed during 2013 visit of Premier Li Yang of China. Actually, he had come and he made a very good statement at that time. And that statement I would like to read out. The two sides, India and China, appreciated the progress made in promoting cooperation under the BCIM regional forum. The forum was actually working even before that. So this was in fact a kind of you can say a result of that, these forums meetings. Encouraged by successful BCIM Car Rally was actually organized, breaking many protocols by Indian side and by Chinese side. That was a very fortunate thing to happen that time. But that was not well covered in the press. The Car Rally was covered, but hardly any news media or academic medium brought out the fact that actually both establishments worked together behind the scene, and they made this particular Car Rally happen, and that actually took place, and that was very well encouraged. That was the part that was covered in the media many times. So the two sides agreed to consult the other parties with a view to establishing a joint study group on strengthening connectivity in this region. for closer economic trade and people-to-people linkages and to initiate the development of this whole corridor. So this was the statement that was given by Premier Lee Kyan. Now this proposal again was further reaffirmed when Manmohan Singh visited in October, same year, China. So I don't have that statement with me because that statement is still not on the public information site of Government of India. But he actually reaffirmed these statements and these point of views. But recently, now see how situation changes in international relations so fast. From 2013 to 2017, when the last GSG meeting happened in Kolkata, this year, 2017, India didn't send its joint secretary level officer, which they were demanding for a long time. Rather, they sent an additional secretary level officer, which is quite junior in the ranks. His name is Hitesh Sharma, who expressed Indian side's apprehensions again after such a series of very engaging discussions and all, when they were all looking forward that something will come out of this corridor talk very soon. Now, see this statement. We should be mindful, this Indian official talk, we should be mindful of different domestic circumstances and developmental aspirations in our respective countries. While we focus on expanding trade volumes, equal attention should also be paid to its sustainability. Greater access to each other's market is desirable to achieve more viable and sustainable trade cooperation. So the words like is desirable, is equal attention should be paid, this should happen, that should happen, this ought not have happened, or this. So all these are indicating somehow that Indian side is still hibernating many, is still harboring many apprehensions which they were carrying before 2013. So you can't see any very major transition in Indian foreign policies. The way they think about, especially to China, wherever China is involved, they will be thinking in a particular way. And interestingly, I would like to read out here. Yeah. The statement at the same forum by Chinese official, and see who's China sends who. China sends its NDRC's chief. NDRC, we all know, happens to be one of the premier bodies in China that decides on planning and development all the time. It's not like our planning commission that where you propose a thing and we just want to listen to. That happens actually in China. So China's highly productive approach was could be seen in this statement. This was Wang Xiaotao. I hope I can pronounce some Chinese names properly after moving to China. Just once. So he said, it was just one line, that there is a need to put in place an intergovernmental cooperation mechanism for the success of the proposed initiative. So they actually, Chinese want to move from track 2 to track 1, which India has not been listening. India has been always saying that, okay, track 2, track 2, they won't say anything, but actually it will be meantime. But see the attitude of China, they want to go to the track 1 level. And track 1 level is in time and again being refused in some sense by the Indian establishment. So the Chinese call for a faster move on this project is not a matter of equity. Ambiguity, while Indian side's statements are always seemingly dissuading and not so fulfilling, in fact. In fact, in Bangladesh also, when the meeting happened, India was not prepared at the time. See, in 2014 again, when India participated in the same joint study group meeting that was held in Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh, place we all know about it. There again, Chinese were hoping that the promise that Indian government did commit there 28 months back, that we will be coming up and we will be wrapping up this joint study group meeting report and we will be tabling it, we will be discussing that and we will be deciding on some sort of action that could bring this, take this dialogue from track 2 to track 1 actually. But India again did not do that, in fact, to its task. This task remained unaccomplished even at that time and later as well. So we all can engage what India and foreign policy has been doing for a long time. They have been only engaging with Pakistan. Pakistan is the sole concern for India. In fact, for the last many decades, I can tell you, for the last 25 years at least I have seen, because last 25 years, for 20 years, 15 years, I have been observing Indian political system and foreign policy establishments. They haven't been doing anything. In fact, many of us, even a journalist, will tell you that what Indian foreign policy has been doing. China is their concern only when it comes to the borders. Pakistan is their concern only. Pakistan is their sole concern, and there is no third country that comes to their concern. You can look at their attitudes when Sheikh Hasina visits when people from other countries visit, when people from America or people from European delegations visit. Just not working on. Nothing is working on except some certain trade ties and defense ties, obviously. And why defense ties are booming, we all know. So, and coming to the conclusion, I will talk about just two small things. Now, why Narendra Modi government, I'm talking about Narendra Modi government now, why Modi government is especially being a little considerate towards all the BCIM corridors, including many other corridors, including many other talks that are not China. We all know it's a recent phenomenon in the Rakhines, I don't know how to pronounce it, Rakhine or Rakhine in Western Myanmar. So Rakhine state and Rohingya, the crisis that has been raging out there, and this crisis happened many years ago there then, but then I can't recall what was India's response that time, but it was at least better than this crisis response. So first, before I talk about that, India, I would like to inform you that India has only 70 out of about 50 identified roads along the Siam Indian border. But post Doklam, this has emerged as the top priority of Narendra Modi government. This first thing. Secondly, the vulnerability of that 22 kilometer wide chicken's neck that connects India to its northeastern region has also emerged as one of the top priorities of this Narendra Modi government. So these are the two top priorities, and these are the concerns which are actually pushing India to think of this BCIM corridor to be a kind of alternate arrangement where they can exploit and sort of defend its country against any possible attack by Chinese, which I don't think will happen. So, in order to fulfill that, India is actually has started once again to develop its deep sea port at Sitwe is again in the Rakhine, near Rakhine, that province, northwestern province. And they are also working on that Sitwe Mizoram highway that is going to be called National Highway number 54 in the coming months or coming years. Nobody knows how the National Highway is a part of the real world. So, lastly, the North Bloc's, Indian North Bloc, which we all know what we mean by North Bloc. North Bloc's response during last few weeks to the impending Rohingya crisis has hit India's carefully cultivated bilateral relations with Dhaka. And this was also pointed very recently written by eminent foreign policy specialist Shyam Sharma, India Today magazine. He's very recently. So he is actually talking about why Bangladesh is important for India and why Myanmar is important for India. Rather than getting us to the same question of why India should not counter China if it really wants to have a bring that kind of development for the northeastern region and other regions as well. So I'll just come to the last point. So India, I think personally that Bangladesh's transit points and infrastructure have remained very much embedded in India's present options of reaching to its northeastern region and also beyond in case of any sort of exigency, which will not happen again. Time and again, I will reiterate that. So at the same time, India needs Myanmar for shooting its strategic goals and internal security challenges. It's time, just to sum it up in one line, it's time that the Narendra Modi government really acted on India's act-east policy, which they have been acting on so long. Thank you very much, and I will be looking forward to the questions at the end of the session.
Thank you. In your position. Thank you, Neeraj.
Thank you, sir.
Just one point I would like to mention that though I am not a personal fan of the Prime Minister of India, but I must admit, I think Professor Mitra will also concur with me that he is the first Prime Minister whose engagement with Eastern India was maximum. And I think you see other prime ministers from the end onwards, the engagement was relatively less. In fact, when Mr. Manmohan Singh was the Reserve Bank governor, he appointed ISAS-ADRI committee for Eastern India for agricultural development. That report was not implemented. But as far as the current prime minister is concerned, he is very much engaged with Eastern India, though he denied Central University status to Patna University. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is state society relation and economic performance in Odisha, Dr. Sujin Singh.
Today, I would like to share my study of state society relations and economic performance in Odisha. In fact, this is based on one of the chapters in my book, which will be published by Cambridge University Press next year. And I think Odisha is a good example of Eastern states and India to be discussed, as the state has both economic prospects and socio-political problems. And however, Orissa has been underexplored in scholarly literature for a long time, either on its state or on its society. And thus, I hope my work on Orissa contributes to fruitfully today's roundtable discussion aims. Discussion consists of five parts. First, I will sketch Orissa's geographic and political features. Then, I will present Orissa's economic performance with select socio-economic. After that, I move to the debate of state-society relations in Orissa. And in this part, I will introduce two perspectives looking at the political economy of development in Orissa. First one is a state perspective, state-centered perspective, and the other one is society-centered view. In the discussion, I will suggest the model of Orissa state as a neo-patrimonial one based on empirical evidence I collected from field work and secondary sources. The discussion is followed by explanation of how Orissa's industrialization has been pursued since the 1967 State Assembly election, when the regional party's coalition politics was born. This part of the discussion implies a hypothesis that close state and capital, private sector relationship is a driving force to industrialization. I will emphasize that the ideas favoring the private sector, especially India's domestic and foreign capital for industrialization, emerged in the 1970s in the state. However, the government of Orissa failed to realize such ideas due to many socio-political reasons in the 1970s and 80s. In fact, Orissa's industrialization began taking place after 1990, with limited institutional capacity in encouraging the private sector to participate in the state's industry. Interestingly, Orissa's socioeconomic performance has improved in the most recent years, especially after in the mid-2000s. I will attempt to suggest the reasons why Orissa seems to be in the transition toward developmental stage much later than others of national states. And the needs of some future research will be suggested through the concluding remark. The number of population in the state was around 42 million in the 2011 census, and Orissa is the ninth largest state in terms of geographical territory among some national states in India. Its capital city is Bhubaneswar, as I mark as a red dot on the right side. The state consists of 30 districts. The number of state assembly constituents is 147, and Orissa has 21 seats in Lok Sabha. And 2011 census said Orissa's literacy rate was 73.45%, which is slightly lower than that of India average, which was 74%. Net state domestic product was around 40,000 Indian rupees in 2011. And the current ruling party is Bijusanadal, and Chief Minister is Navin Patnaik. And here are a couple of maps that can help our understanding of Orissa's socioeconomic status. The left-hand side map presents the state-wise literacy rate in India. And as I just mentioned before in this previous slide, the literacy rate in Orissa was around 73%, which is a little below that the India average, 74%. And if we compare it with that of other neighboring states, then it's higher than that of Bihar and Andhra Pradesh, but it's much lower than that of West Bengal and other western states in India. And the right-hand side map shows the GDP per capita, the state-wise distribution, and the Orissa's per capita income is also lower than that of India average. You can see not only Orissa, but also the other most of other eastern states in India and northern northeastern states are struggling from the income generation. And now let's look at some political maps of India. The left hand side graph shows the pattern of Orissa state assembly elections results from 2000 to 2014. The green line is BJP, orange is BJP, and the blue line is Congress. It is clear that the BJP has substantially increased the number of seats in the state assembly elections by winning since its emergence in 1997. BJP won 20 out of 21 parliamentary seats in the last Lok Sabha election in 2014. And BJP could secure only one seat from Sundagarh constituency, which is on the borderline between Orissa, Chhattisgarh, and Jharkhand. The right-hand side of Orissa map is colored based on 2014 state election. And again, the green part is BJP, orange color is BJP, blue part shows Congress victory, and the red dot is Orissa's capital city, Mitra. And we can see that BJP occupies the absolute majority in 117 constituencies out of 147. And BJP is aiming at winning the next state election in 2019, but it seems quite difficult for BJP to achieve the majority without aligning with the BJP. And now we see some of socioeconomic indicators in Orissa. And table 1 presents the percentage of population below the poverty line in select states in India from 73 to 2005. And there were only 6 states among many in India, of which percentage of population below poverty line was higher than India average in 1973. And they were Kerala, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and Orissa. And Orissa in the 1970s was the most backward state in this regard, as Orissa's BPL rate was 66.1% in 73 and 74. The trend of low economic performance in Orissa in reducing poverty remained until the mid-2000s. As Table 1 shows, the poverty reduction rate of Orissa from 70s to 2005 was the lowest among the 6 states in India. The poverty reduction rate of Orissa during the period was around 30%, while that of India average was 15%. And even other economically backward states, which we know as Bimagra states, such as Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, they performed much better on that Orissa in reducing poverty in the period. However, Orissa made a substantial change from the mid-2000s. Table 2 indicates that the percentage of population BPL from 2004 to 2012 in select states in India. 8 states were performing poorly then in reducing poverty in the mid-2000s. The 8 states were Jharkhand, Tripura, Orissa, Uttar Pradesh, Manipur, Bihar, Chhattisgarh, and Maharashtra. And the percentage of population BPL in each state, 8 states, was much higher than average of India's other sub-Asian states in India. And Orissa's BPL rate was the highest in those years, in the mid-2000, marking 57.2%. which was much higher than 37% of the India average. It is interesting, however, to see the poverty reduction rate that Orissa made from 2004 to 2012. Orissa's poverty reduction rate during the period was 67%, while the average of poverty reduction rate in all sub-national states in India was around 41%. So it is more intriguing that Orissa performed much better in the period than Maharashtra, of which industrial capitalization level was much higher than other submission states in India. And here is a graph which confuses the socioeconomic progress that government of Orissa is recently making. This represents human development indices, HDIs in short, in 27 subnational states in India. Based on 2011 census, the orange color vertical bars indicate the overall human development index of the states. And the red color bar is the average of HDI in all subnational states in India. The black color circles mean education dimension index, and the crosses in small white boxes show the income dimension index of the states. And the black diamonds are health dimension index of the states. The states are placed in descending orders of the overall HDI from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. And Orissa's HDI is the lowest among the 20 select states in the graph. Now we can think of a question that the BJP government present good performance in reducing poverty is not necessarily consistent with its performance in human development. And my recent question on Orissa's low level of development in terms of industrialization pays attention to the state-society relationship that is not conducive to state industrialization. And many of the existing literature looking at Orissa from a state-centered perspective see there are so many socio-political problems in the state. The state bureaucrats lack accountability, and there is no enforceable power to punish government officers who do not fulfill the duties. Also, governance is poor, institutions implementing the state development are inefficient to catch up modernization. There is no political will in reducing poverty in the state. In fact, when we consider the study arguing this, did not cover the BJP's current regime. This needs to be revisited though. And other studies observed the low level of delivering the interest of marginalized groups through a panchayat study, and rent-seeking behaviors of political leaders through political incentives and the degree of corruption study. Well, interestingly, Jennifer Basel's study was finding that in Orissa, there were a lot of cases of quick corruption and substantial delay in policy adoption. And based on aforementioned studies, I'm raising a question that Orissa is close to a neo-patrimonial state. The neo-patrimonial state was modeled by Peter Evans in studying the Zairean state and by Arthur Kobe in analyzing the developmental process in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh in India. And I will go into the details of neo-patrimonial state's nature in the next part of this session. And on the contrary to Orissa's studies from the state-centered perspective, many studies with society-centered view deal with the structural characteristics of Odia society, such as underdevelopment, poverty, and identity of local tribal groups in Orissa. And also, they tend to highlight economic backwardness or tribal-dominant demography. And for example, some found that that the lack of social capital and civic engagement contributed to the weak mobilization for protesting against the large-scale investment and development and used to displacement. And some others observed how big businesses have exploited natural resources and involved in gang development and used to displacement in Orissa. And I argue that the neo-patrimonial nature of state structure and solidified the exclusionary state society relationship in Orissa, especially in the 1970s and 80s. The main characteristics of neo-patrimonial state highlight that the state is less capable of pursuing collective goals before seeking individual incumbents' interest. Also, the state is struggling against the lack of institutional moorings and lack of public goals. And further, upper middle group base of regional parties in Orissa supporting the argument. The ruling, regional ruling parties, they didn't capitalize on the 1967 election, local election victory for the state's development and inclusion in policies. and neither the Congress Party, which ruled the Orissa for a long time before BJP emerged in the late 1990s, nor regional parties which came to power have a strong connection with citizens belonging to the weaker sections in society. This weak category-based organization of ruling parties has been a critical factor in the political instability in Orissa. And the weak party organization and weak support from the grassroots level easily allowed party leaders to create fictions, and there was no efficient system to monitor them. And frequent conflicts, political factions, and corruption cases in the Congress Party influenced Orissa's unstable and unpredictable politics in the period. And you will be really surprised to hear there were five times of the president's rule period in Orissa from 1970 to 1980, just for 10 years. And corrupt leaders and bureaucrats blocked the reform in land, taxation, and rehabilitation. And citizens were getting divided more and more between upper middle group in the coastal area and the marginalized groups in the forest area. Left-wing extremist mobilization of the uneducated and unemployed citizens has threatened the state governments. Due to such social-political reasons and environment, the idea of industrializing Orissa failed to be materialized until 1990. Biju Patnaik, who is remembered as a great leader to many Oriya citizens, was longing for the state's industrialization for a long time. He had an idea of developing the state through the public-private partnership for a long time, especially in the steel and mining sectors. During his tenure as the Minister of the Steel and Mines in the Janata Party government at the union level, well, interestingly, Biju Patnaik was open to an idea of collaborating with the foreign firms in technology assistance, also taking notes from foreign countries. Well, our chair, Dr. Gupta, also mentioned, you know, the importance of domestic capital, well, not only foreign capital, especially domestic capital's development in the process of generating growth in the state. When considering the financial deficit in the Orissa in the 1970s, Biju Patnaik's idea was convincing. Several state agencies implementing industrial policy were also established in this period. The Industrial Promotion and Investment Corporation of Orissa, which is well known as IPICO, was founded in 1973. And Orissa Resettlement and Rehabilitation Policy was also introduced in 1977 to help the people, displace the people from the industrialization process. However, Biju Patnaik's idea on industrializing Orissa was not realized due to many social-political reasons I discussed before. In fact, Biju Patnaik himself was one of the political leaders who were involving the faction of politics both in the union and the state levels. And you may be surprised to see him changing his political party affiliation three or four times. First to Congress, to Gupta Congress, and then further to Janata Party and the BJP. Then only after Biju Patnaik became the Chief Minister of Orissa in 1990, some of his ideas were realized. The power sector reform based on privatized regulation model with the World Bank's assistance was one of them. And also, Fusco, a South Korean steel company which dropped its steel plant in Paradis recently, was initially approached by Biju Patnaik as early as in 1990. Fusco rejected the proposal by then, though, and then it was struggling for a long time and then finally dropped the project. The state's industrialization plans became more detailed in 2004 through Orissa Industries Facilitation Act under Navin Patnaik's leadership. The act aimed at streamlining inspection of industries by different state agencies and authorities for the clearance of industrial projects in the state. For attracting the large-scale investments, Team Orissa was launched in BPO. Also, rehabilitation policy was enhanced in 2006. The Orissa Public private partnership policy was structured in only 2007. In fact, many of the state agencies and institutions built and rebuilt in the mid-2000 seem to be producing some of good economic performance after that. Then, however, it seems too early to say that Odisha is now in transition toward the development of state from a patrimonial state and inclusionary society. To conclude, I argue that the exclusionary pattern of state-society relationship was structured and solidified by neo-patrimonial nature of the state, which failed to shape citizenship politics in Odisha. And it provoked citizens, especially the uneducated and unemployed, to be mobilized by the contest groups against the state and industrialization. And especially left-wing extremists, they target mobilized this marginalized group of society. And despite that, the most recent economic performance by the BJP government in reducing poverty confused the exclusionary pattern of state-society relationship. We need to observe further how the state will deploy the industrial and inclusionary policies and schemes by tackling the deep-rooted social political problems.
Thank you, Dr. Shin. I'd like to mention one or two things about Odisha. I think one needs to take into consideration that this is a part of old Bengal presidency. And one of the continuing problems was that this was a permanent settler. And see, three types of latitudinal system was introduced. One was Raitwadi, Mahalwadi, and permanent settlement. Now, if you see historically, in most of the permanent settled area, the state was weak because the public finance collection, even during the British period, was very limited because these were permanently settled. But in the Raitwadi and in the Mahalwadi area, that there was no limitation to that. And because there was no limitation to the public finance, if you see, even during the pre-British period, in most of the, in two of the main presidencies like Madras and Bombay, the per capita expenditure on, say, health, education, and various things was much higher than in Bengal presidency. And even within Bengal presidency, the per capita expenditure was much less in Bihar and Odisha. But Odisha had two advantages. One, Odisha was possibly the only state in eastern India other than Bengal proper, where there was a subnational trigger because of Gopal and various other factors. There was a subnational trigger. And secondly, there was a formation of the middle class. And one of the, for example, one of the contribution of Biju Patnaik, though he changed parties, one of the reasons was that the regional voice was not given importance within Congress. And I think one of the reasons, one of the things which one must attribute to Biju Patnaik, that he was trying to develop regional capitalism in Odisha. And that was signified through his effort to Kalinga-based industrialization. Started several things. Now you will not find that parallel anywhere in the eastern region, other than Bengal proper, which was when there was a Swadeshi movement in 1905. The Swadeshi movement main trigger was in Bengal, but in Bihar there were only three committees, and even those three committees were considered to be Babu Tamasha. Only Bengalis were involved. But in Odisha, there were 3,000 committees. So the idea of Swadeshi means what?
Idea of indigenous capital.
So,
formation of indigenous, formation of subnationalism, is that politically different.
there was seafront, which we had never had, or many other Jharkhand or many other states. That was also an advantage. And I'm sure in recent period, I mean, your data gives a mixed impression, but I'm sure Odisha will not be far behind in the future because of various other activities we don't see in other parts of the state. Thank you so much, it was very interesting.
Thanks, Dr. Gupta. Whosoever is working on water issue or climate change, the problem with us is everyone wants to know that what is the conclusion. Nobody wants to know that what is the content of your paper. So I will start with conclusion first. If you ask me in past also that, so what is the solution of water disputes in South Asia? And like many other people, I would say, okay, shift to demand side way of management of water instead of going for supply side. But at presently, I was working on anti-dam protest, mainly on Sardarsarovar dam. So while working there, I found that even demand side way of management has many problems. And this is a report by World Commission on Dam and World Commission on Large Dams. And in its report, and I am quoting from this, whether to give primacy to options such as demand side management or improving the efficiency of existing supply assets, and under what conditions are also debated. The options debate connects with the political economy of decision making and therefore to the distribution of power and influence within societies. This includes how choices are made between available options and the extent to which market or other institutional factors create barriers and incentives for different options that provide the same service. On the basis of this report and many other means what literature I have, I feel that even the demand side view of management of water disputes in especially in South Asia and within India is not very much foolproof. So we need to go or invent something new. And what's that new is even I don't know. Ask me that, do you know that what that new will be in the case of TISTA also? So I don't know what that new. Coming to the paper, more than India and Bangladesh, the water dispute over river TISTA is between the West Bengal state and Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, river TISTA flows through five northern districts of Rangpur division: Kayabanda, Kurigram, Lal Mohanirhat, Lilpang Mari, and Rangpur, comprising a total of 9,667 square kilometers. Within these five districts, TISTA is catchment area to 35 sub-districts, police stations, and 5,427 villages, with an estimated population of about 9.15 million people. This is according to 2011 census. And presently, the Bangladesh population is 164.65 million. So this means that the population instead of 9.15, it will be around 10.13. The TISTA floodplain covers about 14% of the total crop area of Bangladesh and provides livelihood opportunities directly to approximately 7.3% of its population. The water from TISTA is mainly required during the leanest period from December to March, when the water flow often temporarily comes down to less than 1,000 cubics from 5,000 cubics. This is one of the most important issue of tension between Bangladesh and state of West Bengal, because Bangladesh always Bangladesh insists that they need water between December to March, while West Bengal says no, we cannot give in March, we can give you say April or maybe in August, especially in August, because August is also season. This dispute has its history. It can be located in the report of Bengal Boundary Commission, which was set up in 1947 to demarcate boundary line between India and Pakistan. At that time, East Bengal was part of Pakistan. All India Muslim League, in its report, made a claim for Darjeeling and Jalpaiguri districts on the ground that they are the catchment areas of the Teesta River system. It was then thought that by having the two districts, the then and future hydro projects over River Teesta in those regions would serve the interest of the Muslim majority areas of East Bengal. This was opposed by Indian National Congress and Hindu Mahasabha. In its final report, Sir Radcliffe Commission took demography as important factor, not other factors, which was a mandate under which Radcliffe was working. Even during Pakistan days, East Bengal's river disputes with India was little discussed. This is one of the work which I wanted to show. This is by Abbas, and he was part of 1960s water discussion between India and Pakistan, and in 1970s he was secretary with Bangladesh government, and he discussed water disputes between India and Bangladesh, East Ganga's water. And this is a book on Ganga water disputes. Then, once Bangladesh became a sovereign state in 1971, 1972 Joint River Commission was set up between India and Bangladesh. This Joint River Commission was mainly to look after the Ganges water. But in 1996, after Ganges water treaty was signed between two countries, the focus turned towards Teesta. And in 2000, Bangladesh presented the first draft on Teesta. But it has taken years, it almost took 10 years for both countries to agree upon the new water sharing formula from River Teesta. In 2011, Dr. Manmohan Singh went to Dhaka. At that time, one of his coalition partners, Mamata Banerjee, she refused to sign at the last moment. And what she said, she said that she had earlier agreed to a deal that would ensure that Bangladesh would receive a 48% of share of the Teesta waters. Banerjee subsequently changed her stand, saying she believed that Bangladesh would get 33,000 usage of water instead of the 25,000 usage originally agreed upon. The question at that point was what 48% would be. It would be whether it is 33,000 usage or 25,000 usage. And on this issue, the differences emerged between West Bengal government and the UP government, their center, and Bangladesh government. Even during Modi's visit to Dhaka in 2015, the discussions were there, but the two sides didn't agree. One of the main reasons for West Bengal's reluctance to agree on the present deal is water from Teesta is important for the irrigation of the five districts of North Bengal: Kuch Bihar, Jalpaiguri, South and North Dinajpur, Darjeeling. And these five districts constitute one of the poorest blocks in the region. And it is being assumed that water from River Teesta irrigates the land in these five districts. They would be able to produce three crops in a year. So it is around 1.20 lakh hectares of land they want. They are planning to irrigate during the leanest period, for which they need water, especially the West Bengal water. To look into the load of River Teesta, West Bengal government in 2011 commissioned a study under Kalyan Rudra. He is a famous scientist. And in 2012, Kalyan Rudra came out with his report. That report is a bit, well, I have not seen the report, but this is one of the writings of Kalyan Rudra, where he writes, and this is mainly on North Bengal rivers, Teesta is a part of it. And he, in his writings, focused on the issue of siltation, which is one of the major reasons why I'm giving an issue about, talked about this one, the Farakka barrage, because of the way that part of Bihar had flooded during the monsoon season. And the second issue he has raised is Teesta, what Kalyan Rudra says, is one of the most overexploited and overburdened river in that region. And he writes that The flow in the rivers of North Bengal generally reaches the maximum level in the month of August, when a volume of more than 20,000 million cubic meters of water flows. The shallow cross-sectional areas of these rivers can hardly accommodate the huge monsoonal discharge, and floods are an almost annual event in North Bengal, where a river drops on the plain. This is a loss of energy and resultant deposition on the bed leads to the widening and grading of the channels. The channel form is governed by available discharge, sediment, load, and decline. So this is the words of Kalyan Kundra about North Bengal rivers. And in his other writing also, it was published in 2003 in the Ecologist, he writes that siltation has been one of the major problems, with the projected capacities decreasing at alarming rates, often before the entire project is completed. Evaporation from reservoirs and seeping of water from canals deprive the marginal land of the command area from water. That it was assured during the planning of the project. The dams were designed to moderate floods, have created floods by releasing excess water at the peak of the monsoon. And in 2017, when Ms. Sheikh Hasina was in New Delhi, before her arrival, it was maintained that she is not going to talk about these stuff. But as soon as she landed, she took advantage of every flow and put it wherever she got to raise the issue that Tista is one of the major concerns that India has to do. And especially the focus was on West Bengal, because the government of India has already acted on the new formula. And before, on the day of her arrival, in one of the news published in Hindu, she wrote that we share our Lalan, Rabindranath, Kaji Najrul, Jivananda, there is similarity in our language. We are nourished by the waters of the Padma, Brahmaputra, Tista, and so on. The Sundarbans is our common pride. We don't have any strife over it. Then why should there be any contention over the waters of common rivers? At this position was not imposed by Ms. Mamata Banerjee, and she went on to say that what will I do if there is no water? There is no water in the Tista, Mukut Manipur has dried up, Mahananda has dried up. This is just April, then May, June are up ahead. By the time the rain starts, it will be July. So these 3 months, there are waterways. And then there was a meeting between Ms. Mamata Banerjee and Ashtina, where after meeting, Ms. Banerjee said that your problem is water, not Tista. I am willing to look at any alternate proposal to address your issues. What we can do is that there are many other rivers in the area. We can use water from them. But Sheikh Hasina is insisting on river Tista is because usually what happens is that rivers are not only a physical environment, they are also a part of the political issue and they are also part of your culture. Tista has a deep cultural links with people from that part of Bengal. So, I don't have to know what I have to conclude because the water disputes are such that you cannot say that this can take this state or that state. But still, what I can say that these issues are needed to be managed, because addressing water issue, or if you feel that we are going to resolve these issues, are entirely different propositions. And these water disputes of India with its neighboring countries are going to escalate further in the coming years because of the rise in demand and supply gaps.
Thank you. Dr. Amit Ranjan, I think it's a very fascinating paper. I have no idea about this Tista river problems, other than remembering that Mamata refused to accompany Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, and that was a big setback to him politically also. I just would like to mention only one point, that water problem is a major problem of the world. And Sushant George had mentioned in the other half of the world that the fourth, how the other half died, that fourth world war will take place.
This is the
third.
This is very
over-exaggerated thing. And I just want to mention that the Mansingh Committee in 1950s,
right.
At that time, the member of parliament from Bihar, especially from my district, they opposed this sharing of water from river Gangas, because if the West Bengal is sharing water from river Ganga, then Bihar is also losing.
Yes.
So they started with it. Because the parliament said that, no, we don't want to give our water to Pakistan. India, Pakistan, something like that. First,
Mansingh Committee. Who was the member of parliament from your place?
In Bihar. There were a few members. So I don't remember the name. Mansingh Committee was of the, he headed a committee, India, East Pakistan.
So, whatever is, I beg to differ with you marginally on the question that this is a little bit exaggerated problem. Maybe the third world war will not take place because of the river dispute. But this has become a major problem. For example, the Kaveri. You are seeing it's a day in and day out. It's a major problem there. A major problem as far as this is concerned. And other problems are also coming up. So the question of river linking or the river linking within the same basin, these are increasing questions which are on the national agenda.
River linking also is many questions.
Many questions. Ecological questions and various other things.
Within India and outside India.
Outside
India. When you talk to someone from Bangladesh or someone from Nepal, they say ILR in Italy, they are starting, it means India is going to, that's what all about. And then what you do, you don't have any option. So we should go and support China. We should let China be part of it. And the law is in the country. It is China to discuss. So that you can balance India and balance all your balance. So this is one of the political issues.
So we'll continue in the question answer session. The next paper is by Dr.
So we
have a tea break.
Thank you. We are now adjourned for tea break. Please be back here by 4:25. Thank you.
Yeah.
Are you satisfied? So far?